أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والسماء والطارق وما أدراك ما الطارق النجم الثاقب إن كل نفس لما عليها حافظ فلينظر الإنسان مما خلق خلق من ماء دافق يخرج من بين الصلب والترائب إنه على رجعه لقادر يوم تبلى السرائر فما له من قوة ولا ناصر والسماء ذات الرجع والأرض ذات الصدع إنه لقول فصل وما هو بالهزل إنهم يكيدون كيدا وأكيد كيدا فمهل الكافرين أمهلهم رويدا رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي والحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين ثم أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We're back in Gaithersburg, Maryland. Last week, you guys skipped Surah Al-Buruj. It was conducted out of Texas. And Jazakumullah Khairan, the folks from High Productions and Maimon Media for coming out there and helping out in broadcasting that program live. Just a quick recap of how the beginning of this surah connects with the previous surah, the conclusion of it. At the end of that surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنُ مَجِيدْ فِي لَوْحٍ مَحْفُوظٍ. That is the Qur'an in the protected tablet, fi lawhin mahfuz, and that is of course in the sky. So what was mentioned was the highest thing in the sky, and now this surah begins with the mention of the sky itself, wassama'i wattariq. So what was in the sky, fi lawhin mahfuz, in the previous surah, and now this surah begins with the mention of the sky. The other thing also is towards the end of that surah we read, wallahu min wara'ihim muhit, that Allah is in complete, has completely encompassed them from behind them and from in front of them. And here in the very beginning of the surah, we will read, in kullu nafsin lamma alayha hafiz, that there is not a single person in existence, that there isn't a guardian over them, a watchful over them. And inshallah ta'ala, we will see how that is explained as the surah continues. This surah is essentially divided into five sections. And we'll try and finish the first two sections before the salah. The first four ayat, ayahs 1 to 4, are an oath that Allah Azza wa Jal takes by the sky, and by this thing we're going to study called At-Tariq. Was-sama'i wa-t-tariq. And then Allah Azza wa Jal dedicates two more ayat to the discourse on the Tariq, on just that particular aspect of the oath, and then gives us what's called Jawab al-Qasam, the response to the oath. We've talked about this before. When Allah swears by something, then you have to have a response. There's muqsam bihi and muqsam alayhi. In other words, I swear, then you say, I swear what? I swear I'll do this, I'll do that, etc., etc. That's called jawab al-qasam, the response to the oath. And that is in the ayah, the fourth ayah, in kullu nafsin lamma alayha hafiz. So let's begin, inshallah ta'ala. We begin, first of all, with the first ayah, which is very similar in style and format to the previous surah's beginning. In the previous surah, we read, was-sama'i dhatil buruj. Here we're reading, was-sama'i wa-t-tariq. So it's paralleled with the previous surah. Allah Azza wa Jal swears by the sky. The sky, the word sama' comes from someone, or sumu also, which means that which is above. So commonly we translate it as the sky, but really sama' is something, everything above. And this is slightly different from the term samawat. In the Qur'an, Allah Azza wa Jal uses the word sab'a samawat in tibaqa, for example, in Surah Nuh, and many other places. خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ. Right? He created the heavens and the earth, as it's commonly translated. What's interesting is the word sama, generally speaking, means everything above us. Everything above. Because that's what the root meaning comes from. But samawat is seven heavens. Seven layers of sky. Actually, sama is more than samawat, which sounds strange. Sama, you would think one sama, one sky, and then seven of them would be greater. But since the word sama means everything above, it even includes more than the seven heavens. For example, Allah Azza wa Jal, His arsh is where? It's above the seven heavens, right? So we don't say that it's in the samawat, but we do say it's in the sama. It's still in the larger. So Allah never says, أَرَأَيْتُم مَن فِي السَّمَوَاتِ, but He does say, أَرَأَيْتُم مَن فِي السَّمَاءِ, because that's a limitless term. Samawat is still a limited term, and sama is a limitless term. Nonetheless, when the word sama occurs with a clarification or a qualification, then it refers to usually the first sky. For example, in the Quran, we find as-sama ad-dunya. Okay, as-sama ad-dunya, which refers to the first sky. So without qualification, it refers to everything above, limitless. But when we say as-sama ad-dunya, then it's referring to the first or any other qualification that's been placed. Here, the qualification or the limit that's been placed on it is the phrase wat-tariq. And we will see why that's a limitation in a bit. Allah Azza wa Jal swears by the sky, and as a reminder, what is the function and purpose of taking an oath? The number one reason an oath is taken in the Quran, it is an illustration of Allah taking a creation and making it a witness. That's the primary thing. Okay. So in English, we would say, I swear by the sky. But one of the implied meanings that doesn't come out in translation is, I am making the sky a witness. That's one of the implications of saying wassama'i. The sky is a witness to what I'm about to say. The sky is also, you know, a precursor or an introduction to what the discourse that is about to come. Allah Azza wa Jalla says the word tariq. A tariq is the one that arrives at night, is the common translation. It comes from the word taraqa, which is to walk along it. It's an ism fa'il from it. It's an active participle from it. The word tariq comes from this word. And tariq means a road. And the reason it's called tariq, literally taraqa or turq means strike. And a road that you walk around on a lot, the animals traveling on it, the people are traveling on it, different kinds of vehicles are traveling on it, it gets hit a lot. It gets beat up. That's why it's called tariq. That's where the word comes from. Now the word tariq is used specifically when someone travels at nighttime. It's used for the one who travels at nighttime. Why? Because the Arabs, they found it more convenient to travel at night because the day was scorching hot. So they would travel more so at night than they would during the day. We find in Lugha, wa aslu tarqi al-darb, right? The essence of the word tarq is striking. Okay. The other thing here, what is tariq really referring to? One more implied meaning from the language we learn is tariq refers to someone who comes in the middle of the night, because if they're traveling at night, they reach their destination at night, and then they knock on the door. But if you knock on the door during the day, nobody cares because there's all this noise during the day. But at nighttime, everything's quiet. So you hear it, and it's louder than normal when you hear that at night. So the essential linguistic idea behind the word tariq is that which arrives at night, number one. That which calls attention, because the one who's knocking on the door is causing a lot of attention in the still of the night. This refers to the large, brilliant stars in the sky. There are two opinions about it. Either it's referring to one major star, and there are different opinions about what that star is. Some say it's Zuhal, which used to appear to the Arabs when they would travel in the last portion of the night. They would see this brilliant star, and the night traveler would kind of wait for them to see it. It was like a highlight of their journey, that they got to see that companion of that journey, that Zuhal, again. Others would say, no, the tariq, because the general word is used, it's referring to all brilliant stars in the sky, all of them. And it's as though the night is kind of a relief for the Arab. And so, since the word tariq is used for someone who arrives at nighttime and calls a lot of attention, this is the beauty of their nightlife. You know, the desert isn't much to look at, but what's the only beautiful thing in the desert that's really remarkable is the night sky that is embedded with these pearls of the stars. So this is what the word tariq literally refers to. Allah Azza wa Jal, then He goes on to say, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الطَّارِقُ. What will give you any clue? What has given you a clue, rather? It's in the past tense. Is there anything that can inform you or give you an indication as to what the tariq really is? Now the thing is, you know, in Lugha we find the way it's been interpreted is أَيُّ شَيْءٍ أَعْلَمَكَ بِذَلِكَ الطَّارِقِ. What is something that's going to give you a clue as to what this tariq, this arriver at night is? Allah Himself answers this question by saying النَّجْمُ الثَّاقِبِ, the next ayah. But why even ask this question? This question is asked usually in the Quran when the answer to it cannot be known by the human being. And then Allah Himself answers the question. Now there's another similar format in the Quran where He says, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ, not مَا أَدْرَاكَ, but وَمَا yudrika. This is the mudari' form, the present form. Whenever Allah uses wama yudrika, what will inform you, what will give you a clue, as opposed to saying what has given you a clue in the past, whenever he uses the present or future tense, he doesn't answer the question. He doesn't answer. But when he says wama adraka, he will tell you. So here he asked the rhetorical question, what would give you a clue? What is it that may have given you a clue? What it is? And then he answers himself, al-najmu al-thaqib. The ulama have commented about the format of this question, and they let us know that the reason Allah Azza wa Jalla asked this question is, even if you can see the star, you can never truly appreciate it. You don't know its reality. What you know is a small glimpse of what that star really is. So when Allah uses ma adraka, then usually it's referring to something. You can imagine something about it. You may know some things about it, but its full extent, you will never appreciate, you will never taste. So this is something remarkable that Allah Azza wa Jalla calls our attention to, that we are in no position to fully grasp what Tariq really is, even if you see its beautiful, you know, a gloss and its beautiful shine in the middle of the night. It's not something you can fully envelop. This is why also in the Quran we find, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِمَوَاقِعِ النُّجُومِ. I swear by the position of the stars, Allah says. But then he says, وَإِنَّهُ لَقَسَمٌ لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عَظِيمٌ. And that, no doubt, if you had any idea, is an enormous oath. This is not something small. It's something tremendous. I highly encourage all of you, inshallah, if you get a chance, I think it's on YouTube now, it's Dr. Abdul Hay, who's a Muslim senior analyst at NASA, who's done this really nice PowerPoint presentation called Allah's Universe. And he puts our creation, the creation of the earth, in perspective with the rest of the universe and how really minuscule and insignificant we are. It's really an iman-increasing presentation to watch. It's something great for yourself, and inshallah ta'ala, especially to share with your children. Anyhow, so Allah lets us know we're in no position to appreciate what Tariq really is. And as far apart as that is, and if you're into like astronomy and you know something about, you know, space and the vastness of space and all of this stuff, then know something about this deen that's really profound. Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَلَقَدْ زَيِّنَ السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحٍ. We beautified the worldly sky, the first sama, with these beautiful lamps, meaning the stars. So far as the human beings, no matter what telescope or what tools we use to look into the universe and find stars, so long as they are stars, that still counts as what heaven? The first heaven. And how many heavens are there? There's seven heavens, subhanAllah. So as far as there are stars, that's still the first heaven, because Allah says Allah decorated the first sky, the closest sky, with stars. This occurs in Surah Al-Mulk also, زَيَّنَ السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِزِينَةٍ لِلْكَوَاكِبِ. Same thing. That we've decorated the first, the closest sky, the sky of the dunya, that's the one we've decorated with the beauty of planets and stars. That's what he's done, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا أَضْرَاكَ مَا الطَّارِقِ. What will give you any clue as to what that tariq is? Then Allah says, النَّجْمُ الثَّاقِبِ. Najm, you all know, it came up before. The word najm means star. But here it has been given an adjective, and the adjective is thaqib. Thaqib comes from the word thaqaba. And thaqaba means of a fire or a star to be brilliant, almost like blazing and twinkling. The other thing that comes from it is thaquba, which means a fire to something similar in redness than to fire. And when light passes through something, this is also from thaqaba, to rip through something. And the idea presented here is, imagine the black night as a blanket. Right? And imagine the light is like a hole poking through the blanket. Right? Put yourself in that position. It's daytime, you have a blanket over your head. And if there's a window in the room, you can still tell it's day. Because somehow the light pierces through even that blanket that you have over you. So the image by Allah Azza wa Jalla saying thaqib is that of light that pierces through vast, vast distances and reaches all the way to you as you're looking up into the sky. And now we know more, but just understand it from the perspective of the desert Arab. Even he would think that how long this light has traveled, how far a distance it has come to reach me, it pierced through all of those vast distances. Now, one of the central themes of this surah that we have to, inshallah, keep in mind as we continue, it's part of the language and theme of this surah, is journey. One of the things we'll find is journeys. For instance, in the word thaqib is the journey of the light that travels, that twinkle that travels from the origin of it, from that najm all the way to us. That's one journey. In ayat that are coming, we're going to find the journey of the fluid that travels all the way to the womb and then forms the human being. There's another journey that's coming. So we have that theme of journeys. Another theme that's going to be consistent here is secrecy. Of course, what time is associated with secrets? Day or night? It's nighttime. And the surah begins with mention of the nighttime. وَالسَّمَاءِ وَالطَّارِقِ وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَالطَّارِقِ And this star, النَّجْمُ الثَّاقِبِ, it's as though it's unveiling the secret of the darkness of the night. It's producing light where you only expect darkness. SubhanAllah. Now, inshallah ta'ala, as we go further, before we go further, a couple of things about the mention of stars in the sky. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَبِالنَّجْمِ هُمْ يَهْتَدُونَ This is what Allah Himself says, that by the stars they are guided. In other words, the Arabs would look at the stars very carefully, because when you're traveling at night, you can't see the sun and tell if I'm going east or west or north or south. The only way to tell now is guiding stars. They would look at stars as milestones, basically, for them to be able to travel through the night. So Allah is calling attention to something that they look at constantly anyway. Allah is making them think of it in a different way. And this is one of the very important psychological features of the Qur'an. Allah Azza wa Jal wants you to look at things you see every day, but now He wants you to completely change the way you think about those things. Or He wants you to think about certain things that you never thought about when you saw them. In other words, Allah talks about the earth. We look at the earth all the time. Allah told the mushrik in coming surahs, we'll read, why don't you look at the camel, how it was created, because he's seeing the camel all the time. Why don't you see the mountains, because when he sees the plain of the desert, what's at the end of the horizon? There's the mountains. There's the sky, he can never escape. The ocean, now these are things you cannot escape. You always see them, basically, right? But Allah wants you to see them, but then He wants you to associate a kind of thought with them that you never did before. This is Jawab al-Qasam. That's what it does here. So in other words, when a believer internalizes the ayat of the Qur'an, the next time they see a star in the sky, you know what they remember? They remember the response to this oath. Not just, yes, وَالسَّمَاءِ وَالطَّارِقِ وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَالطَّارِقِ النَّجْمُ الثَّاقِبِ But you know what that reminds them of? That conclusion. In kullu nafsin lamma alayha hafiz. There is not a single person. There is not a single nafs. There is not a single person. I don't want to use the word soul because it can be misleading a little bit. That does not have a guardian placed over it. Now this is the second time we're reading about a guardian placed over it. We read already, inna alaykum lahafidheen kiraman katibin. This is of course referring to the angels. Another opinion is that this guardian that Allah refers to here is Allah Himself. Okay, وَلَا يَؤُودُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا Some have quoted Ayatul Kursi in the context of this, that Allah Himself is the guardian over all of them. But the stronger opinion, and that also of the Jamhur, is that this is the guardian that was mentioned before, إِنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ لَحَافِظِينَ كِرَامًا كَاتِبِينَ Something you should note about this ayah, and what is the connection between this and the sky and the piercing light? Ulama have commented that the night, the stars are so far away, and yet it is as though these are eyes. In our times, we would say they're like cameras stationed towards the earth. Because when Allah says, وَالسَّمَاءِ وَالطَّارِقِ He has made the sky a witness, and the tariq, the star, the brilliant star, a witness. And a witness is obviously someone who sees something. So the star and the sky, they are seeing our behavior. And on the day of resurrection, perhaps they even are witness to our behavior. Allah says He has installed these magnificent witnesses, so it's not too far-fetched that each of you has been given personalized, you know, guardians over everything that you do. The other thing we find in the Sunnah literature, we find two kinds of angels. Angels that protect us from all kinds of troubles, that if they weren't there, that the shayateen would cause us all kinds of harm. That's we find in authentic Sunnah literature. Then of course we find the mention of angels in Quran and Sunnah that are recording our deeds. Now the difference between them in language is, here we say, عَلَيْهَا حَافِظ عَلَيْكُمْ حَافِظِينَ The word ala means they are not there for you, they are there in a sense almost against you, watching over you, in other words, documenting your deeds. If this was in kullu nafsin lamma laha hafidh, then they're there protecting you. That's referring to a different kind of angels. But that's not what's being talked about. In other words, this isn't talking about guardian angels in the way we think of that in English literature. Angels that are guarding you. But they're actually guarding the information of all of the deeds that you do. That's what they're there to guard. They're there to guard that nothing you do, nothing you, even, you know, the wink of an eye, يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ Right? Even a little bit of a glimpse of an eye that doesn't escape. That's what they're there for. Not a single person is there that doesn't have a hafidh over them. The scary reality this ayah reveals is that we're never alone. Of course, Allah Azza wa Jalla is witness all the time, but even beyond that, the angels have been assigned for each of us. We are never, ever, ever alone. That doesn't exist for us. In kullu nafsin lamma alayha hafiz. Now, here we notice something peculiar in the language, which is interesting. The word in usually is beginning of jumla shartiyah, it means if. But the word in this ayah is taken from another tribe. Their Arabic was slightly different from the normal Arabic of the Quraysh. This is called Qabilat Abu Huzail or Huzail also. And these people, their in was like ma. So actually it's ma kullu nafsin, and their lamma, which is different in the language of Quraysh and different in the tribe of Huzail, they would say ma, we would say ma kullu nafsin illa alayha hafiz. That's how it's understood in lugha. If you look at any linguistic analysis of this surah, they'll say the same thing. Ma kullu nafsin illa alayha hafiz. But rare usage has been used. Usage that is not normally thought about. Usage that makes you, first of all, it's an indication that the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, even though he does not come into contact with a certain tribe, he still knows their dialect because the angel is revealing to him not just the dialect of the Quraysh, but other dialects also. And this is part of the miracle of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Additionally, what this tells us is, this is kind of, it fits poetically into the theme of secrecy. This format is sort of unknown and rare and distant for the Arab. Just like that star is so distant. Just like for him, the idea of the angel watching over him and everything he does is distant. So the format of the language is such. In kullu nafsin lamma alayha hafiz. And then we should note that this phrase has a great degree of emphasis in it. Don't ever lose sight of the fact that it is absolutely true that every single person, all times of, you know, of all hours of all days, has a watcher over them, has a guardian over them. Some discourse that we should take into consideration in regards to this ayah. First of all, we find a hadith in regards to the other kind of angels, the ones that protect. Allah says in the hadith, or the Messenger says in the hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَكَّلَ بِالرَّحِمِ مَلَكًا. Allah has installed, even in the wombs, angels. He has appointed angels to guard and protect, even in the wombs. From that time, we are not alone. And then forth. The other thing, حفظ هو الرعاية الذي يراعي المحفوظ. This word حافظ comes from حفظ, which is protection, that which is offered to the one that is being protected. In other words, these angels, in this case we said they're not protecting us necessarily, they're protecting the information, all of our deeds. They're guarding all of our actions and our behaviors, so all of them are thoroughly recorded. Now, the second thing that I should note here is why use the word كل and not use the word جميع. You see the ayah says, in كل نفسٍ. And in the Quran, jami' is also used. Now jami' kul means every, and jami' means all together. So what's the difference between them? You see, if you use the word jami', it implies that the people are together. And only then they have a guardian over them. But kul means each and everyone in their own individual place. Regardless of whether we're together or not, this is something that's taking place. So jami', for example, is used in the case of the next life and resurrection, because there, in fact, we will first be herded all together. وَإِنْ كُلُّ لَمَّا جَمِيعُ لَّدَيْنَا مُحْضَرُونَ. Jami' is used. But here, kul is used essentially. Okay. The other thing here is the word عَلَيْهَا preceding. In other words, Allah does not say إِنْ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ لَمَّا حَافِظٌ عَلَيْهَا. عَلَيْهَا is not at the end. عَلَيْهَا is in the middle. This is what's called taqdeem. The benefit of knowing that is that every one of us has specifically been assigned an angel. Or specifically been assigned a hafiz. That is for us. That's their job. Their job is us. As opposed to some other person, they have another angel assigned to them, and it's very, very particular to every single human being. This is part of the qadr and the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other thing we should note about this ayah is the use of the word nafs, as opposed to the word insan. Allah does not say, in kullu insanin lamma alayha hafidh. He says, in kullu nafsin. Interestingly, in the next ayah we'll find, فَلْيَنْظُرِ النَّفْسَ أَوْ فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانِ مِمَّا خُلِقْ. We find insan in the next ayah. But in the previous ayah, we find the word nafs. So two different words are being used for the person, for the human being. What's the benefit in knowing this? The other, we said before, one of the consistent themes of the surah is secrecy. Is secrecy. And the nafs, the word nafs is associated with that which keeps secrets. You hide something in your nafs. Fi anfusihim. Right? Inside of themselves. So the word nafs is associated with that which is inside of us. The word insan is of course the whole human being, but the word alludes to more of forgetfulness because it comes from nasiya, so its theme has to do with forgetfulness. And we'll see how that applies in the next ayah. But this is about secrecy because the nafs thinks they have some things that can keep a secret that nobody's going to find out. But Allah says, no, you have a guardian over you. Even that nafs that is known for keeping secrets, none of its secrets are safe because there's a hafidh over it. Alright, so then inshallah ta'ala we continue. فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ مِمَّا خُلِقْ. Then the human being should take a deep look. And the word fa here, first of all, It doesn't say liyanzur, it says falyanzur. The fa means then as a result. Then as a result. Meaning if a person realizes, has given thought to the fact that there are these brilliant stars that are a witness against him, that the entire sky, if you don't see the stars, it's cloudy. Allah didn't just take an oath by At-Tariq that sometimes you see, sometimes you don't see. He took it for the whole sky first. As-sama, the sky is a witness. And then on top of that, if you see it, the Tariq is also a witness. And Najm al-Thaqib is a witness. If you've pondered over these witnesses, and if you've pondered over the reality that there's a guardian over you that is recording all of your deeds, then it should lead you to think, why is this not far-fetched? Why is this not a fantasy thing that we believe in? Because the average non-believer, when he hears this, he thinks we're talking about some fairy tale, some mythology of angels around us and, you know, these stars are watching over us. Come on, they're just inanimate objects in space. They're nothing. It's just empty air. It's the vastness of space. Nothing's a witness. So they think this is the figment of our imagination. Allah Azza wa Jalla calls this disbeliever to reflect in a different way. He calls him to say, Allah says, فَلْيَنْظُرْ. Then, if you're skeptical about all of this, then the human being should look carefully. They should look and reflect carefully. Nazara is to stare at something and to think about it. Like for example, when Musa alayhi salam took out his hand and it was white, right? فَإِذَا هِيَ بَيْضَاءُ لِلنَّاظِرِينَ. It turned white for those to stare at, meaning people couldn't take their eyes off of the thing. Right? They're just staring at it. They're just, what is that? How did that get here? Allah uses that word for us. In other words, we should reflect deeply, look carefully into. And then the irony of the wording here, that's part of the imagery of the text is, we said darkness, secrecy, hiding, nafs is something that hides, right? The nighttime, tariq, alluding to the nighttime, something that hides. Allah says, look into what you were created from. Let the human being look into from what he was created. And the word for human being used is insan, because the human being tends to forget what he was created from. The human being gains credentials or wealth or status or a name or power or authority in the earth and forgets that he has some very pathetic, not just humble, pathetic beginnings, a dirty fluid that people wash off of their clothes. That's where his beginning is. So فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانِ. Then you see the word mimma. In the language, you see, normally we say mimma with an alif there. But this has been shortened mimma. Mimma is a kind of tasghir, also taqseer. It's been reduced, it's reducing the meaning of the word. In other words, how small a thing. Even in the language, it's been reduced because what he's been created from is something very small, very minuscule, very insignificant, so much so it doesn't even deserve to be called mimma khuliq. It should just be called mimma khuliq. Mimma khuliq. The other thing here, again, as far as the language, is the word khuliq. Allah doesn't say, فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ مِمَّا خَلَقَ اللَّهِ مِمَّا خَلَقَهُ اللَّهِ. He says, خُلِقَ. The human being should look carefully and ponder deeply into from what was he created, the passive form. From what was he created. Allah does not say from what Allah created him. In other words, Allah did not mention himself. He kept his name secret in the text. And this is part consistent with the style of the surah. Allah does not mention his name. Now when Allah Azza wa Jal does not mention his name and he mentions the passive form of the verb. In other words, in language we say, he killed. Now you know he did the act of killing. But when you say he was killed, I didn't mention the killer. It became a secret. So when Allah says what he was created from, it illustrates a couple of things. One, Allah's displeasure. Meaning when Allah does not want to associate his name with this forgetful human being, he just says what he was created from. He doesn't even mention his name next to him. This happens in the Fatiha, for example. We find an'amta. An'amta, you favored. We mention Allah, you favored. But when we come to those who earn wrath, we don't say ghadibta. Right? We just say what? Al-maghdubi. Those who received wrath. Allah's name is not mentioned. When favor is mentioned, Allah's name is mentioned. But when anger is mentioned, Allah is so angry, he doesn't even mention his name next to him. He says al-maghdubi alayhim. Right? So Allah's name is not mentioned. Here Allah's name is not mentioned, illustrating Allah's anger over this person's forgetfulness. The second thing it's illustrating is he's not expected to think about Allah. This person has become so forgetful that the thought that will run his mind is not Allah created me, what did Allah create me from? At the very least, just think, what were you created from? Forget the creator even. That much is not even expected from you here. The only thing expected from you is reflect deeply into your own creation. Just the word creation, but not mentioning the creator himself, right? Because this person is in denial, so let's just make him think about what he can see. The first few ayat are about beliefs in what you cannot see. Now Allah is calling you to think and reflect about something that you can see, that you can reflect about, but they take a lot of careful insight. Now think of the desert Arab of the time. Can he look inside the body where the fluid comes from, he can't. Allah Azza wa Jal poses the challenge to him in this surah, but he only sees what comes out. So Allah says, خُلِقَ مِن مَاءٍ دَافِقٍ. The human being, he was created from this water, ma, but he gives the water an adjective, which is dafiq. Which is, it's beautiful in the surah because the star was given an adjective, which was thaqib. The star was given the adjective thaqib, which pierces through, drills a hole and comes all this distance through and reaches you. The light that pierces through, that's called thaqib. It pokes a hole in the darkness. The word dafiq means that which pushes, that which breaks through. Like if water breaks a dam and comes through, it's called dafiq. If you take a mug, it's full of water, you turn it over. All of it just gushes out all at the same time. This is ma'un dafiq. This is what difq is. So Allah says water that gushes out immediately. It comes right out, comes right through. It's consistent with the imagery of the surah, subhanallah. So we say, dafaq al-ma'u wad-dam'u, also it's used in literature. Water came out with force or blood started gushing out. Just like, you know, you can't stop it. That kind of blood coming out. We find the difq also, ma'in the difq, that's how it's been explained, meaning water that is only associated with gushing, it's never still. That kind of water that's never still, it's only in gushing form, subhanAllah. Then, as we go forward, I want you to keep in mind the reflection that Allah Azza wa Jal wants us to keep associated. So far we have reflected on things we cannot see, we have reflected on things that come out of our own body, ma'in dafiq, that fluid which is the origin of the human being, putting him in his place. But then Allah Azza wa Jal goes further and says there's another journey. The journey of this water that gushes forward. What is this journey? يَخْرُجُ مِن بَيْنِ الصُّلْبِ وَالتَّرَائِبِ. That's where the journey begins. The journey of the light that travels all the way and comes to you, the tariq that comes to you, it began with a najm. The journey of this fluid, it begins where? يَخْرُجُ مِن بَيْنِ الصُّلْبِ وَالتَّرَائِبِ. Sulb means something hard. And one of the hardest bones in the body is the spine. It's the toughest, the back, right? And one of the words for the back in Arabic, or specifically the spine, is sulb. Okay. Also the loins, for example, min aslabihim, right? From their loins, meaning from their lineage. That's how it's used also. Now Allah says from your spine, the back of your spine, and at-tara'ib is the chest bones. Okay, these bones right here. So for example, we find the singular of it is at-tariba, and hiya idham as-sadr, as we find in the Lisan al-Arab and Bahrul Muhit and other texts, that the chest bone and the backbone. And Allah says this journey begins somewhere inside you. Now some have looked at this scientifically and said, okay, the sulb and its linguistic meaning and the spine and where does sperm actually develop from, where does money begin, right, where is it formulated, etc. But think of it from the time of the desert Arab who's hearing it for the first time. What's going on in his head? This is a very small amount of space. Right? And Allah Azza wa Jal has depicted to him a mystery that has not to be solved for a good millennium and a half since that was said. A few ayat ago, he was depicting a journey of millions and if not billions of miles. And now, this small body of yours seems like an endless ocean because you can't figure out this mystery. SubhanAllah. So not only are you incapable of encompassing the vastness of the sama', you can't even totally figure out what's going on inside of you. This is illustrating the powerlessness of the human being. This is how when the Arab hears it, يَخْرُجُ مِن بَيْنِ الصُّلْبِ وَالتَّرَائِبِ, it's still a mystery to him. Allah didn't point the specific place. Jazakallah khair. Right? He didn't point out the specific place. And this is the beauty of this surah. It puts together two concepts that Allah puts elsewhere in the Quran. He says, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ. We will soon show them our miraculous signs in the horizons and even within themselves until it becomes absolutely clear to them that that is the truth. That this in fact is the truth, subhanAllah. So this is really the beginning theme of the surah. يَخْرُجُ مِن بَيْنِ الصُّلْبِ وَالتَّرَائِبِ. One more ayah inshaAllah ta'ala briefly and then we'll conclude. بِإِذْنِ. Actually, before we go to the next ayah, I should probably stop. Before we get to the next ayah, just say one more thing about this ayah. You know, we've already read previously a similar Allah Azza wa Jal calling the human being to what his beginnings are. But there the crime was kufr. Allah says, قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَهُ مِنْ أَيِّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقَهُ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ خَلَقَهُ فَقَدَّرَهُ. You know, may the human being be killed, may he be destroyed. How horrible, how vicious is this belief? What was he created from? From this nutfa, from this droplet. Right? Similar text. But there the crime of the human being was denial. He came into contact with it, he denied. Here it begins from an even beginning point. Allah calls him insan, not kafir here. Meaning the point here is forgetfulness. Human being just, he went about his life and completely forgot his own origin and forgot to stop and think and reflect about it. Allah makes him look outside in the horizons, then he makes him look inside of himself. And then inshallah ta'ala, as the surah continues, we'll see what conclusion Allah Azza wa Jal wants us to reach in the next coming ayat. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.